Hello. Hey, Momo. Thank you. Hey, guys. Thank you for joining us today.
So today we're having Paul Paulino, and he's going to ha to be basically sharing with us his process in Mari when it comes to texturing, and he'll also share with you his amazing journey towards becoming a texture artist from having a graphic design background. Paul, I'll give it to you. Just say what's up, introduce yourself, and we'll take it from there.
Cool. First of all, thank you guys for joining us again. Thank you, Momo, for the invite. I think it's great to be here talking to you. I think it'll be a really nice stream, and it'll be nice to answer questions, right? Just checking, Momo, because I can't see the screen here on Twitch. Are people like seeing us right now? Like, is there any comments or?
People are going
'Cause like
to see us. Basically, what it does is Twitch basically streams my streams this channel to the Learn Squared channel on Twitch. But because it's a hosting system, it takes a couple seconds for the stream to start being visible on that end.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
Okay.
but
Cool.
yeah, we're live at this point.
Sweet. Awesome. Thank you. Sorry, because I'm a noob on Twitch. I have
It's
to start using more often right now.
totally fine, man.
Cool. So let's start talking a little bit about my journey into VFX.
Yeah, like how did you, first of all, where are you from? Right now you're based in Canada, but yeah, if you could just introduce yourself very quickly.
Cool. So my name is Paul, and actually, I'm from Brazil, and I came from a city, a really small city in Brazil called Almenara, and I lived there my whole life. I lived there for like 18 years almost, and it was funny because like when I was living in the city, it was a really, really small city, a small town in Brazil, right? And we didn't have access to anything related to video or like movies or anything like that. We only had to like buy those VHSs, you know? So it was really like difficult to get access to like to culture and information. But even with all the these problems, I was able to my family, they were always like buying VHSs, so I was always watching Jurassic Park. You know, like Jurassic Park to me was like one of the greatest movies, you know, like that inspired me to, you know, to get into this career.
Like the first one,
Because I,
right?
the first one, yeah, when I watch it, because I didn't even go to the movies, to the theaters, you know, because we didn't have one.
Gotcha.
I think the first time I went to the theater was in 2006, and I was what, I was born in 1991, so I was like 15 years old. Yeah,
Gotcha.
15 years old. It was the first time I remember going to the theaters. So it was really difficult, but it didn't stop me of like keep searching for, you know, like inspiration and stuff. So I lived in the city for like 18 years, and but back then I started to get involved with video, like
Keep
you know, like when
searching.
you get a
Inspirations.
group of friends and then you start recording yourselves. Oh, let's make like a movie, right? Because I remember when I was 14, no, 13, 14, I started like writing scripts, like writing stories on my own, like I don't know, teenager stories, you know, like oh, this guy falls in love with that girl, and you know, based on where you live. So I started writing these stories, and when I was like 15, we had an assignment in school where my teacher said, "Hey, I want you guys to make like a what it's called, a play, right? A theater play. So write something like very simple, and then you're going to present that to the whole class. That's it." But back then, I was already interested on like movies and recording something, you know, making something different. So I had like my friends, and then I asked them like, "Hey guys, why don't we make like a like a movie. You know, let's record something, edit it, and make a movie out of it. So, and all my friends just started laughing, like, are you crazy, man? I mean, because imagine that in a really small town in Brazil, right? We didn't have access to anything. People didn't even know what editing was, right? So it was like a really bold idea. And, but all my friends, after like that day, I remember going home and they started writing the script of the movie.
Gotcha.
The short movie, right? And then the next day I presented the script to my friends and they're like, oh shit, that looks cool. You know? So they were super excited about it. It was pretty much like a Western idea. It was just like a Western, a goofy Western short film, right?
And did you guys, did you guys have like, did you cast actors at that point? Like, did you go through the like full pipeline of you know, like shooting a movie, or was it more like on an amateur like side?
It was really amateur. I mean, I can actually show you guys the trailer of it. I still have it on YouTube.
That's
fine. I don't show this to a lot of people because the thing is we were the only ones like being part of it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, let me share the screen here. I can send you the link as well afterward.
Yeah.
But yeah, okay. Can you see it?
Yep.
Yeah. So it was like this really amateur, like handmade, like video. So I found like a camera in my place. My dad had it, and then we started like recording. So, but we got like proper clothes, you know, like so because the city, the town that we used to live with in, it was like really hot. So we had like a really good places to record, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at it, like the actual set was quite good, right? And so we found like clothes. I got this clothes from my parents. I stole it from my mom and my dad's, and she was really mad at me back then. That's because really I lent it. Yeah, so this is me actually.
Yeah, I can tell.
And we had to speak in English because it was an English class, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which was really difficult for us because, you know, we speak Portuguese and English isn't our first language. So some of my friends, they didn't know English very well. I mean, I didn't know English either. I mean, I knew a little bit, but I was pretty much reading stuff. But we have a friend called Guilherme, which is this guy here. And he didn't know English at all, not even reading it. So what we had to do, we put a phrase for him. So he would say, the book is on the table on each sentence. And he would just say that, but with the emotion of the moment, right?
Yeah.
Based on what he had to say. And then later we put like a subtitle with the actual meaning of that phrase.
Gotcha.
So he was saying the book's on the table all the time, but it was quite good. I mean, we had horses. Look at that. We had horses and we put a lot of effort on that.
And
you know, and
what age was this? How old were you guys at this time?
This was in 2006. Yeah, we uploaded this in 2007, but this was recorded in 2006. We were 15 years old. And this guy here, so we didn't have enough actors, right? So this guy, my friend Guilherme, he was like all the other actors. So he was like this dancer. he was like a can-can dancer. And he was like the bartender, you know?
Yeah.
So, but the cool thing is it was really, really fun. And as soon as we finished the movie and we showed that in school, the director, he asked us to present that to like over like 300 people, you know, because everyone was so like astonished by it. Like, oh, these guys, they made something, you know, really interesting. It had a story and it was like really good. So after I did that, I started getting interested in those, you know, like in making movies, making short movies. So that's why I started like getting more interested in these things.
So how did you go from shooting movies to graphic design?
Yeah, so this is like my old YouTube channel where I have a few, videos that I made in this process. So I started like getting interested and learning from the internet. Like back then, this was like 2007. We didn't have enough information, right, online. So it was really, really hard. But I found, well, we had a social media back then called Orkut. Do you know this social
No,
media?
no, no.
It was really popular in Brazil. And the cool thing is we had like a lot of communities that you can share information. So I made a lot of friends there. And it's funny because nowadays here in Vancouver, there's a really good friend of mine called Tito. And we met there back in 2007. And he was the guy who taught me pretty much like everything I know about video making, right? And we came to Vancouver together like 10 years later. And we never met each other in real in person before that day. And we met each other the day we came to Vancouver to study VFX. That was like one of the greatest stories of my life, you know? And this guy was like, he's like one of my greatest friends. So here you can see I have some videos that I've made back then. But so when I went to college, I went to study advertising. And I started, I kept working with video, like recording videos and stuff.
As a medium.
I wanted to become a director back then. I decided that I wanted to be like a director, a movie director. But then I went into school, I'm like, yeah, that's kind of hard, especially in Brazil. So I said, okay, I still want to do that, but how can I get there, right? So I started to find like ways to develop my skills. So I started to work with like video editing, video recording, journalism.
Your screen went dark, by the way, Paul.
Sorry?
Your screen went dark.
Yeah? Oh, okay,
There
sorry.
you go.
Is it back?
Now it's back. Yeah, you're good.
Okay, cool. Sorry about that. Cool. And here, so I was like recording a lot of videos back in school. I was working with video editing, video recording. And then I decided, so after I was working in school, I got a job in a TV station. And I was working at the art department. And we had to make like motion graphism for TV, which is pretty much like those letters, that appears like, oh, the name of the guy or something like that.
Like title cards.
Title cards, exactly. That's the name. Title cards. So we had to do like animations for it. And back then, I only knew a little bit of After Effects because I discovered After Effects when I was studying video, just to make like color correction and just a little bit of animation, just a tiny bit, right? So I got really excited about it. So I found this course online, and they were teaching motion graphics. And I was like, okay, that's cool. Let's see how, what I can learn from it. So I learned motion. So I started learning motion graphics, and this is like one of the assignments that I did for the course. It was just like the
Yeah, that was the trend back
magnetic.
then, just having like typography moving around with like camera panning, and I remember. Man, this makes you look a little old, although you're super young. It makes me look even older, man. I'm looking at this, I'm like,
Yeah,
shit.
this was the dude, this was the shit back then, and you couldn't find any tutorial on it, right? Because since it was so like a brand new, like people were starting this. I remember that back in this is what 2011. Holy shit! So back then, my friend Tito, he was also into motion graphics, and he was like, man, how can we make that? And then I found this tutorial online, right? That was teaching like the basics of it. And I'm like, oh my God. So that's why we started doing this. And then I did like quite a few. And dude, I learned so much from these exercises. Like I learned about a lot about design itself when it comes to like deciding typographies, what looks good, what it doesn't. So even though it wasn't like, oh, this is, it's not related to VFX per se, I would say that I developed my eye like a lot, you know?
Yeah,
I did a few here.
That's something that I find a lot of graphic designers who transition to the entertaining side of things. There's definitely a huge advantage because you get to have a sense of composition, although you know you're not dealing with rules of perspective and certain rules that you have to tackle when doing an illustration or a painting, but just the ideas of contrast, the ideas of scale, the ideas of balance, understanding typography. So when it comes to concept art, having a good sense of how to brand something, how to use patterns and so on, those are things that can that becomes a really big advantage and that can help sort of flatten the learning curve. So that basically when like taking that graphic design background, where did you move it next? Did you go straight to, like at which point did you move to Canada? Was it soon after that or?
It was, was kind of like a harsh transition for me.
Okay.
Because I was working with motion graphics, right? And I worked in a few places back in Brazil. I was developing myself as a motion graphics artist, and I kind of let it go, that dream to become a director. Okay. Because to me, it's always like, I was just like doing what I wanted, right? Like if I was interested in this, I would do it. Right. I would never be like, because some people, I feel like they have this, like, they just have one dream in life. I want to become that.
Yeah.
Right. And I feel like that's kind of, it can be really frustrating because if you get like a really disappointment saying like, and you got rejected and you can be like really frustrated with that.
Mm-hmm.
And especially like I came from a really small town. I didn't have enough like perspective in life, right? Like, but I didn't. Fortunately, my family we had enough money. They have enough money to support me, right? So I was really privileged to have this opportunity to study abroad and even outside my town, right? Some people didn't even have the opportunity to leave the town.
Gotcha.
I had the opportunity to leave when I was 18, but I feel like, instead of like having dreams,
mm-hmm.
I feel like we should have objectives. So what I did was like, okay, I want to become a director, right? But in the city that I moved in, we didn't have any university that would teach you how to become a director,
mm-hmm.
right? So what I had to do, I had to choose something that would help me, you know, to keep following my objective. So when I chose advertising, I get in touch to other people. I met a lot of people. That's what one of the best things about universities and colleges is, just like the opportunity to meet other people and talk to them, you know, like on a daily basis and share information. That's why when a lot of people ask me, oh, should I go to college? Should I study somewhere? Or should I just study online? I'm like, it's really up to you. But what I can say based on my experience is like, if you have the opportunity to study somewhere, I feel like studying is always good, you know?
Yeah.
Even though it's not something directly related to what you want to do, it's always going to add something in your life. Not just studying, but anything, right? Like if you work, let's say,
yeah, it's life experience, right? As soon as you look at you know, like taking an art course is not the only way to learn about art. You can learn about art by looking at things around you or just by a lot of great movies, award-winning documentaries and stuff are inspired by either real events or things that have been, you know, just how do you call it, Like big events that have impacted you emotionally. It could be, you know, the way you look at things, learning how to look at things, how to see things. And in those cases, sometimes having a mentor is super useful, but there's all these different ways to you can basically grow from all these different areas.
Yes, yes. And I mean, even if you work, let's say, if you work at Starbucks, right, and you feel like, oh, this is meaningless to my life, right? I would say, like, back when I was really, I was young, I was like 13, 14, I used to go and help my dad. He used to ask for my help to help, like, because he has like a beer distribution company, mm-hmm. right? So he would sell beer, and then he had like trucks that would deliver the beer and to places, right? To supermarkets and places like that, liquor stores.
Yeah.
So I used to help him during like holidays that his employees would be like away. So I would go there and help them. So even back then, some people would say, oh, but this is meaningless. You're not learning anything from it. But I remember learning how to deal with people, right? Like how to talk. Even though I was super young, I had to be like presentable, right? Because I was representing my dad's business, right? Yeah. So I remember learning from it. So I think like everything in life, you can learn something from it. And I would say like, okay, so I graduated in advertising and I learned a lot about marketing back then, a lot about like how to market myself. And that's like really good for me because like if you look what I've been doing right now, I've been putting a lot of effort on like how to present myself to get like in social media and you know, like so I'm putting a lot of the things that I learned back then into my life right now, right? So that's why I say like you never lose knowledge. Everything that you learn is always going to be part of your life somehow.
But there's that, like you need that life experience and that maturity to sort of, you know, start realizing, oh, like this thing that I learned a while ago, I can actually turn it into a tool to better this part of my life. That's something I sort of realized the moment I left my parents' house. Like I went abroad to study, same thing. And that was the first time, for instance, that I witnessed bullying. And,
oh, really?
And I remember just thinking in my head, you know, if you actually want to survive this, like just being outside of, you know, like the parental protection and all that, like you need to start putting to practice all these things your dad taught you from all these years. And I still remember that specific moment. But yeah, like you have these key moments in life where it's almost like a puzzle. Things start clicking in and you start realizing uh-huh. what helps what and what would solve what. And yeah, your problem solving techniques just becomes quicker, more efficient and sharper. Yeah, totally, man.
Yeah. And I'm actually, it's a funny thing that you're talking about problem solving, because that's something really important that I want to talk about. And I'm actually going to write an article about that.
Nice.
Like how problem solving is one of the best skills you can have, not just in VFX, but in like anything really, because.
Go ahead.
No, just like if you're a problem solver, dude, you can do anything, right? If you have the correct mindset and you know how to, you know, troubleshoot with other people, it's amazing. It's a really good skill to have.
Yeah, your screen is black again. I think it's probably, oh. If you don't move, it just
oh,
goes
okay.
into. But yeah, guys, basically, Paul just referred to an article he's about to drop. You guys should go and check his website out. I'm actually posting it. And Paul, if you don't mind going and showing exactly, Paul's been writing a bunch of really awesome articles. The first one I read, and that's how I actually sort of contacted him on Facebook and was like, hey, you're a texture artist. Like, I've been trying to wrap my brain around this whole process. Can you help me out? And I've been sending Paul some of my models just to get like quick feedback on my progress. And yeah. he's been writing these amazing articles that I think anyone in the chat right now should just go and just have a quick look, because it'll give you a quick sort of peek into, you know, let's say what his first year in the VFX industry looked like, what are some of the skills that, you know, and mistakes that he's learned from, and that you need to develop to be, you know, a good team player and to develop new skills and to stay relevant in your craft. So, you know, subscribe to his stuff. I know I do. And anytime something comes out, there's always like a really good, you know, piece of knowledge that I try to apply.
Thank you, Momo. Yeah. And I'm sorry if I've been like harsh on my critiques when you send me stuff.
No, it's good, it's just, man.
Because that's one thing that I've been getting a lot of messages as soon as I started writing these articles and tutorials. I have a lot of people like asking me like for feedback about texturing and stuff. And one of the things that I tell them before is like, hey, do you want me to critique this or do you want us to become friends? You know, like it's just like because I believe in honesty, right? I don't want to like. There's a lot of people that they don't care much and they just say like, oh, it looks great, right?
Yeah.
But I mean, of course, sometimes we don't have time to answer everybody, but I would like to be honest and say like, hey man, like I feel like you still have to develop these skills. I feel like you have to develop your eye a little bit more. And I'm not saying that I know all this, like everything, because I mean, I just started, right? But what I can do is just like share a little bit of what I've learned, right? And what I know that is right and what you can develop, right?
Yeah, it's like art directing in a way.
Yeah, but it's hard sometimes, you know, because it's not that, I mean, I'm never like rude. I'm always like, I'm trying to be as respectful. Yeah. Oh my God.
Two immigrants on the chat. Guys, yeah. Just bear with us. It's fine.
Sorry, guys. So I try to be as nice as I can, you know, but yeah, some people take it nicely, but other people, they just like stop answering. I'm like, okay, it's nothing I can do, but.
No, but I think that's, you know, that's also one thing that you don't necessarily learn in when you're taking an online school, unless you have access to a really solid community that's not full of trolls. They'll discourage you from you know, staying the course and all that. But when you do go to an institution or a school or something, that's one great thing, because you are surrounded by peers that are, you know, going through the same program, so that have more or less the same goals as you, and this was one of my biggest issue with education, because I would have professors who were just cruising through the program, so you would show something really horrible, let's say something really solid that you've put your heart in, and you know, get like really good feedback. Oh, this is really great, good work, da da da. You would do the same the next week and literally spend like 10 minutes just before going into class, and you would still get the same feedback. So there is no way for you to really grow, because you weren't getting honest feedback, which I think is super key. When you're learning something, and because money is a big part of education at this point, especially art education, like you know the money that goes in there is insane. But it's you always need to be, if you're going into art education, you always need to look for that like honest feedback, and if you can't get it from your instructors, try to find it in your peers. Try to find your own mentor or things like that. But that is key. You don't want anyone patting you in the back and you know, sort of pointing you to the wrong direction and you're not aware of it. You want to know that, you know, your skills are lacking, that you actually need to double the amount of effort that you're putting in to hit that milestone that you're looking for. So yeah, it's important to like getting that feedback. I don't think you've been rude. I think you've been very honest and pointing at things like very clearly and so on.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I feel like what I just said is something that I see a lot in the industry as well. It's just like you have to be able to listen to critiques, right, and not take it personally. Because if you're working and some in your lead or your supervisor say like, oh, this is wrong, this is not there yet, they're not going to be like rude or disrespectful, right? They're only going to say like, hey, maybe you can change that and, you know, make it like this. So you have to take it, don't take it personally, right? Yeah. Just like, just write it down, say like, okay, that's what I can improve. And you're always going to learn a lot from it. Trust me.
Yeah.
The next time, I mean, of course, in life, you're always going to find someone that is just like, because you can find people that just want to be, they're going to be rude or disrespectful, right? Like they just want to, I don't know. But like with my experience, I only had people that wanted just the best, right, for the project we're working on. So just don't take it personally and make the, you know, just do the best you can to make it look good based on the critiques, and you're definitely going to learn from it. I've been learning a lot, man. I mean, every time I get a critique, I'm always like pumped to you know, fix it and learn from it. Mm-hmm. And because when I was young, when I started working, I remember because I used to work by myself when I was in that small town, right?
Yeah.
So everything I used to do, everyone would say, oh my God, that's the greatest thing ever. Look at this video. You know, like that's, the, you know, that you're the new Steven Spielberg.
Your screen is black again, Paul.
Oh my God, I have to stop. I have to keep doing this.
Can we just take 2 seconds? Is there a way for you to remove the screensaver?
Oh yeah. Let me just.
Okay, I'll just give me 1 second. I'll transition the screen. Clean. It'll just be 2 seconds, guys. That way we get that sorted out.
Cool. 1 second. Power and sleep. It's weird because it has 25 minutes here on the screen.
Or just keep showing and moving your mouse. That display. Should take care of it.
Yeah, I'm just going to keep moving my mouse.
Okay.
cool.
We're back.
Okay, so what was it? What I was talking about again?
Just the idea of.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So, people were saying, your stuff is great. You know, you don't have to change anything. You're amazing. But the thing is, if you are in a place where you are the only guy doing this, right? How do you expect the people to judge, you know, your work, right?
Yeah.
So, say me anything? Oh, sorry.
Yeah, the screen is still black.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but wait, now it's good. Now you're fine. You're fine. I think it's when you go on Skype, it turns black.
Oh, okay. So, is there a way I can hide this thing here?
If you can move it to a different screen, or just move it down in the corner, that should take care of it.
Okay,
someone says it's not black, it's just that the Skype is black when you see the chat. So I don't know but yeah,
okay.
Right now you're good.
Okay, cool. Let me click on something more interesting. so when I was like making those videos back in, you know, in my city, saying, oh, you're amazing, whatever. And when I moved to another city and I started college, I was surrounded by a lot of talented people, right, that were doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. And I realized that I sucked, you know, and I'm like, okay, so I suck. What do to get better, right? And that's one of the things I realized in life as well with my experiences. You have to be able to say, I suck, right? You're not, you know, the best you're not going to be the best video maker ever. You know, like, you just have to be able to get the critique and learn from it. And I've been doing that every day. You know, even right now, like, I'm working in a different industry and I've been doing the same thing. I'm always willing to learn something new. I'm always willing to, even if it's someone like that has less experience than me, right? Because that's one of the things that I realized. You're going to meet some people that they have like a huge ego. And just because you have less experience, if you want to teach them something, they're not going to take it, because they're going to think, oh, I know more than you, yeah. Right?
Yeah, yeah, you're so either too young or you know, you don't have my experience type of thing. Yeah, ego stuff.
Yeah, and that's one of the things I love about the industry here, at least my experience at Scanline. It's just like everyone, dude, like there's a lot of people like super experienced there. There's a lot of like really talented artists there. And I'm just a junior, right? I'm a noob. I just started this industry. But even when I say something, they never take me for granted. Oh, if it makes sense, of course, right? If I say something like, oh, maybe we should do this, they always say like, yeah, that's a good idea. Let's do it, right? Mm-hmm. And in Brazil, I had experiences working in like way, like really small, like smaller companies where some artists, they would do the contract. They were just like, oh, okay, you think you know something, right? Yeah. So that's a problem, you know, when you meet people like that have like this huge ego, and yeah, it's really complicated.
Yeah, like Austin, anyhow, this guy in the chat is mentioning something that's actually true too, which is almost like the flip side of things, where, you know, just because you haven't reached a certain milestone or a certain skill level, when people around you start discouraging you and telling you, you know what, this is not for you, get a real job, you know, you're not going to make it as an artist and so on. And that's true. Like, I've seen so many, you know, talented people, and yes, the skill level wasn't in par for whatever they were looking for, but that's because they also weren't surrounded, they weren't in the right environment for that. And sometimes just, you know, giving someone the proper tools and the proper direction goes a long way to improving their skills. You see a lot of people, and I, you know, I can mention a few on top of my head, like Jan Urkel, who's a badass concept artist at this point, probably, I believe, mm-hmm. you know, started, went to FZD, like Fang Zhu's art school in Singapore, uh-huh. and did his 1 year degree after like looking, like searching himself all over, you know, at the age of 30 or so, that's when he went there. And uh-huh. within that 1 year, because I don't know the quality of the school, but I know that he did that program for a year, and that was enough to give him all the tools necessary to be one of the leading concept artists in the entertainment industry for both film and video games. And there's a few stories like that. I believe Justin Gobi Fields and others, just having like that good mentorship, like that right environment, can go a long way to sort of hasting that progress.
Yeah, I agree. I totally agree. And when you said that there's a lot of people that is always like discouraging us, I remember back in Brazil, I was working like in this place, and when I was leaving my job, one of my bosses, he said, "You will never become an artist."
Yeah,
you
know, yeah.
I think you should go with production. I think you should do that. It's going to be, you know, I think it'd be better for you if you like leave like the artist side. And that was really harsh, you know, like listening to that was really like harsh for me. But I, you know, like I kept going, you know, I just chose my objectives and I went with it. So,
yeah. Yeah, that's mentors and sort of sticking to your ground is a big is something that can be very valuable in any field, but in art and all of that, it's definitely a big thing to do to get. Like I have a mentor. I've had a mentor since I was like since I started learning about design, which was about, I don't know, 10 years ago or more. But basically, he taught me everything I know without opening any software, without opening any design books. He lent me a couple design books, but most of our conversation were around just looking at things, how to look at things. He would like bring olive oil at school, he would bring like meat, he would bring all these different things and have us look at, the marbling of the fat, look at like the iridescence of the olive oil and all these different things, and sort of putting like he sort of did this thing where he made us curious. He taught us to be curious, and from learning how to be curious, then you start being hungry for information, and that's the key in education. It's so important to find, in my opinion, like what is that thing that will keep you awake and that will give you that, perpetual motivation to learn, because there's so many ways to approach design. Like I have a background in graphic design, but I have, at this point in time, such a big, almost like an allergic reaction, and that's literally how hard it is for me to do, to apply design for advertising, because it's so hard to because my heart is not there. It's as simple as that. My heart is not there. So anytime I need to open any of my tools to do something for Egg Farmers Canada or Chicken Farmers Canada, like it's meaningless to me. But the moment, let's say, I discovered Learn Squared and I discovered that there's a whole different side to design when it comes to entertaining, and that's a whole different approach, that suddenly reignited that fire. And ever since then, yeah, I've been hitting up everyone I can find on Facebook. I've been asking anyone I can find like to spend like 5, 10 minutes with me on Skype or hang out to teach me about stuff that I don't understand. And that's something I'll tell any of you guys. If like don't be afraid to approach people you admire, don't be afraid to send your work to people you admire, asking for support, asking for help. And obviously you have to be smart about it. When you're approaching someone like that for the first time, it's almost like a business contact. So you need to be polite, you
Exactly,
need to
yeah.
be courteous, you need, dear XXX, my name is X, this is my story in like 2, 3 lines, this is where I'm trying to go. Can I get any feedback, or could you drop one or two stone of wisdoms? Like just that in the last year helped me grow so much in terms of understanding 3D, understanding modeling, and now I'm getting to that like hill where I'm starting to understand how texturing and shading works. But yeah, like if whatever it is that you're looking for, if you're having a hard time finding the motivation and everything, try to see where you can tackle it from. Perhaps you're still interested in the same thing, but perhaps from a different point of view, from a different angle. And that can go a long way to boosting that learning curve and helping you get to where your goal like much faster.
Yeah, and that's true, Momo. And the funny thing is, it's I've been doing the same thing, like I've been adding people on LinkedIn and Facebook and talking to them through. I've met so many people, right? Like just by sharing information. And every time I see someone that, like I'm interested on their work or something, a message saying like, hey, Your work is amazing. Nice to meet you. And I like it's funny because you said like how to approach someone, right? And that's super important because after I started like writing my tutorials and articles, like I said, there's a lot of to me like daily. And one thing is, I'll be always like willing to help if you're nice and if you present yourself and say like, my name is whatever, and I've been learning texturing. Could you help me? Could you guide me a little bit? I would always like time to answer you. But if you come to me just saying like, hey, look at this, or hey, give me feedback. like, hey, dude, I'm a person, right? Like, I'm not your,
Your buddy.
I mean, like, hey, I don't even know you, right? Like, I remember this guy to me saying like, hey, dude, can I put my name? Can you put your name in my references? And I'm like, but dude, I don't even know you. He
Yeah.
wanted to put my name on his resume so he could apply to the company that I work for. I'm like, are you crazy? like you could never do that. Like this is like the worst thing you can ask someone because first, your name is gonna be, I'm gonna tell your name to other people, so then they're probably not gonna hire you because of that. I'm not, no, I'm not saying that happened. I'm just saying like, if you do that, you might get your name stained in this industry, and this industry is quite small. So if you're a douchebag, you're probably not gonna find a job, because people are gonna know you. Like, oh, he's that guy, right?
We have a quick question here. Asta is asking,
Sure.
what about basically when it comes to learning, what about guys who learn just the tools and kind of ignore the basics? Because let's say they can't draw or things like that. Like, how important are the fundamentals?
Oh, I just wrote a really good article about that, which
There
is the
you
latest
go.
one. Yeah, how learning new skills changed my career as a digital artist. In this article, I pretty much talk about that. I talked about like how important learning basic skills help here as like in 3D, right? So I shown like, I'm not saying that you must learn how to draw to become a good artist. That's not the point here, really. What I'm saying, can you see my screen?
Yeah, just a little bit,
Oh,
but go ahead.
wait. Well, let me change share window. Okay, good. Because I was looking at the Mari screen. Cool. So I don't think you must. You must learn how to draw to become an artist. Like I just feel like you have to understand other things. I think it's interesting to learn different skills. Like in this article, I talk about how I learned to draw, and how that changed my life. Just by back to the basics and understanding form, perspective, and I also studied painting. Right, so I studied the old masters, understood lighting better. Because tools, it's something that is going to change, right? Like right now, everything is changing so quickly. Like just Substance Painter, like just came out a few years ago, and it's already like changing the industry. So if you get stuck into like a specific software, like you're gonna get obsolete, right? So I think the most important thing is learn the fundamental thing, like learn like the basics of lighting, what makes like a good lighting setup, instead of like, oh, which software should I use to lit the scene?
Yeah, that's
And just like read just and if you want to learn about like more about lighting, for example, I definitely recommend photography. Photography to me is like one of the I've been like I worked as a photographer for a while, and like while I was doing like video as well. So and that taught me so much, like how to understand composition, perspective, like depth of field and all this, and like how like the depth of field works and how can you get like a good composition out of it, And you can even think about like the golden rule and all these things. And when you study photography and composition again, so like this is all like the basics, right? And you can definitely apply that into CG afterwards.
Yeah, Maciej keeps saying that one of the biggest, not the biggest, but one thing that really helped him get a better grasp on 3D was taking Jinya Zing's course on Learn Squared. There's a photography course, and basically he had to recreate. It was like recreating one of the images he would do in, let's say, 3ds Max with like with lighting and all of that, but within a studio context, and that really forced him to understand, you know, where to place light, like how to create mood with light, and all these different things that you learn from photography. And same thing with me, like understanding how to use a DSLR on manual mode, like mm-hmm. completely changes the way you look at things, because then you understand what are the different lights, what are different, how'd you call it, apertures, different lenses. Uh-huh. So whenever you're thinking of a concept or whatever, you can already visualize in your head whether you're thinking telephoto, whether you're thinking wide angle, is it a landscape, and all this photography knowledge goes a long way to sort of informing how you're going to tackle your concept, and takes away a lot of the design decisions, because it's just like little formulas that help you get there much faster.
Yeah, for sure. And the other thing is, if you think about the fundamentals, you know, like if you think about learning light, like how light works, instead of learning how light works in V-Ray, you can learn lights in like a week, mm-hmm. how it works, how you can turn it on and off, and how to position lights. And that's going to take you a week, right? If you put effort on it. But to learn how light really works in real life, it would take you a while, right?
Yeah.
And it's not something that you learn in a week. You're going to be like, okay, got it. I understand how light works. It's not like that. Right. Mm-hmm. Like during my process of learning how to draw, it took me forever to understand perspective,
yeah.
You know, to understand like what the hell is perspective, you know, like because I used to walk around like when I started studying perspective, I had like a perspective class on CGMA, mm-hmm. which was a great class. And I started to do like the exercises by drawing cubes and like understanding the lines where they should go, like the vanishing points and all this stuff. So I started to look at things differently, just like you said, when you started to learn the basics of design, looking at the iridescent and the olive oil and all this stuff. I started to walk around on the streets and look at buildings and thinking about the vanishing points, mm-hmm. right? And this is really important, man. You know, like you go outside and you experience the world the way it is, right? Like just you don't have to do anything to change your mindset. While people are just like passing around, they don't care about anything. When you like open your eyes to this thing, appreciate things like even more, right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's philosophical, man.
No, but that's
you can appreciate things more.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, it might sound lame, you know, like just like, oh, you go outside and you enjoy the light and enjoy like the, but it is true, man. Like it's so beautiful, right?
And it's baby steps. It's something I'm really conscious of now, which wasn't the case even 2 years ago. Like Ryan Render has this really cool name for one of his projects when he was learning Cinema 4D and all that, which was progress before perfection. And that's something I really, like, it stuck to me because it's so important to forget about the goal and focus on the process. And that is really challenging because we have this expectation just from everything that surrounds us, from like the media to entertainment to anything, where, you know, you watch a, you know, blockbuster movie like things we grew up on, where this kid lives in the suburb, he's like just your most random kid, and by the end of the movie he saved the world. And you always have this thing of, you know, you get to your goals so quick and so fast, like that, make money quick, get there quick, and so on. And we forget that when you look into history, when you look at great masters, like that's something, they had such a great amount of focus when it came to studying what they were doing. You know, Leonardo da Vinci, if you guys haven't read or listened to the audiobook, Mastery by Robert Greene. Mastering by Robert
Greene. I really need a book.
It's mind-blowing because it really helps you take away the mystery and that almost like godly thing of these big masters such as Da Vinci, Mozart, and so on. And you realize that these guys were struggling as much as we do, but they did it like people did. You know, they did their everydays. Every day they were at it doing baby steps, baby steps, baby steps. But in the same way, you know, when it comes to money, if you put $100 or whatever amount of money consistently on the side, that money accumulates and grows, and you, that money starts generating its own money. It's the same when it comes to studying stuff. You know, there's a quick question here about the folly of studying more than actually doing. Yes, like I've been super guilty of that whole like frenzy of like finding every tutorial you can find and watching those tutorials instead of actually sitting down and taking my own concept instead of following like click per click. Because when you do that, you don't actually learn. You start developing these different skills, but they're on that short-term memory of your brain. So if you don't practice them, like a month down the line or even 2 weeks, you start forgetting those things. So it's so important to get to the point where you stop focusing on the goal and you start focusing on the process. And the process is individual. Like that's something I've been really working on for the last year, which is understanding what is it that I want to do, what is it that would take me there the quickest, and what is it that I'm doing that's actually wasting my time or that's not a priority at this point. And I did a quick video back in, you know, in the stream, but where I did a mind map for that. And literally, I you know, I always tell this to any of my buddies and anyone, make a mind map of all these different things that you want to do in your career or whatever. Make a mind map. You know, I want to be in the entertainment industry. Okay, what do you want to do there? You know, is it texturing? Is it modeling? Is it VFX? And from there, go, what do I need to learn? What do I already learn? What do I already know? And so on and so forth. And then look at the entire tree and see what it is that isn't useful to you right now. Like I had everything, any software you can think of was on that map, any programming language was on that map. And once I realized, you know what the thing that would help me the quickest, because I already have a 2D background, if I add a bit of 3D and understand how to shade and texture, that's 50% of my work done. So from looking at that map, I just reduced everything to Modo. And once I understood how to model, I moved to shading and texturing. And I'm still there. And that goes a long way to hasten that process.
Yeah. And that's what is said is exactly what I've been telling a lot of people that come to me asking for help. They say, oh, I'm so confused right now. I don't even know where to start, what should I do? And I tell them exactly like what I just said. I just tell them like, you have to organize yourself, right? Create a mind map saying like, okay, what do I want to do, right? Do I want to specialize in VFX games? Because everything has its own
pipeline.
Everything is its own beast pipeline, right? For example, if I want to focus on games, texturing for games, it's a completely different story. I know that right now, like, our industries are merging in a sense, right? Like, the quality of games is getting like so high right now that it's almost the same pipeline as film.
Yeah.
But still, you have to understand how like engines work,
mm-hmm.
Unreal, and how it works, how to integrate your textures into the engine. And as in film, you don't have to, but you have to learn more about renderers like V-Ray or Arnold or anything like that. So it's to like write down what you want, and then you have to find how you're gonna learn that, right? Maybe you go to school, or maybe you find people, these things, and you're gonna ask them directly, and then you write their tips. For example, oh, I'm gonna ask Paul a little bit about Mari, right? And oh, in Mari tutorials. And one other thing is, be careful with just like online resources, like free resources on YouTube, for example, because we have, like you said, we have a ton of tutorials, like amazing tutorials online for free, and paid tutorials, of course, as well. But to find, because we have with so much information, it's hard to reduce that to what we actually need, right? You don't have to learn everything to become a good artist, right? You don't have to learn all the tools in Mari, all the tools in V-Ray. You just have to learn how to make look good, right? Like, and but I my advice to people that, okay, I'm gonna talk about like my specialty, right? If you want to become like a texture painter, a look developer artist, you can start small. And by starting small, you can just like grab a simple asset like this gumball machine here, which was one of my personal works that I did. Let's say I want to make something simple, but I want to make it really like really good. I want to make it realistic, right?
Mm-hmm.
So just choose something simple and try to make it as realistic as you can, right?
Yeah.
And how are you going to achieve that? First, you're going to model and you're going to make it look good. The model has to be good as well, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can't just like, oh, I'm going to fix everything in the texturing side, because that's not going to work. So model it, just make it look good. If it doesn't look good, understand why it doesn't look good. And in the process of like doing it, you have to, let's say, Maya to model this. And in the process, you don't know how to make this bevel, right? And if you can't do it, just ask someone for help. And like, hey, maybe Polycount has a lot of a great community that helps with this kind of stuff, you know, like model things properly, and then that it is, you know, like you got this bevel like working. And then when you move into actually before you have to make UVs, so how to make good UVs, you go there and find like proper tutorials to show you how to, you know, UVs.
Do you have any you can recommend?
I found like a really good on YouTube. I forgot the link right now.
You can send it to me like later, and I'll share it with the guys.
Okay, we'll do that. It's a really good one, just explaining the basics of unwrapping textures in Maya.
Okay.
And I also wrote an article talking about like a few tips to keep in mind while like laying out UVs for visual effects,
mm-hmm.
that might help you as well. But again, you can also ask people like, hey, how can I make my UVs, you know, like look like organized, and how to make this look flat, and how can I, you know, avoid wasting space here, you know? So let's say you're done with the UVs. Now you jump to the software that you want to texture it. Maybe it's Substance Painter, maybe it's Mari. So again, just find people that can help you with it, you know? So it's always like everything is a new step, right? Yeah. And again, if you're not in a school, it's going to be harder, but it's not impossible, right? Mm-hmm. Especially nowadays, like you said, you can reach so many people online, man. And I've never had a problem reaching someone. Sometimes, of course, someone is not going to answer you. Maybe that person doesn't use Facebook that much, or, you know, like, but it's okay. Just find someone else.
Yeah.
Or just throw a message on a forum. Be aware of the trolls, because it's internet, right?
Yeah, definitely.
It's a great place. That's a great place, but be careful. There's always like someone that's going to put you down for no reason, because they, you know, they're frustrated with life.
They're just miserable.
And they're gonna throw that at you. Yeah. So just don't worry about that. Just find the people that are willing to help you for real. And that's why I feel like Facebook is not a great place, no, in my opinion, to do that.
You need to find
forums instead.
Yeah, a good community. Because it's going to be hard. Yeah. It's going to be hard to you know, that whole journey to your destination is going to be hard. And you need to have people you are sure will give you like proper feedback. And you know, when you're down and you're like, guys, I'm tired, I'm not progressing, like this is starting to, you know, really, really like hit me hard. You'll have people to mm-hmm. push you forward and tell you, no, just keep at it, you know, and just give you some more juice to keep on.
Yeah, I agree. And do we have any questions on the stream there? I can't see it.
I guess you can, if we could get like the demo going, people have been, are interested in your process. There's a few questions when it comes to UVs. People are asking, like, do you still need UVs if you're using a 3D painting tool like Mari or Substance? Like, is it still important to do to use UVs?
Yes, please use UVs, guys. For the love of God, please use it. Because that. A lot of people ask me when I wrote that article mm-hmm. about UVs. They're like, yeah, but I don't need UVs. I can do everything procedurally. And I can use, I don't know, triplanar maps everywhere. So fuck UVs. If you're working in production and in a pipeline, UVs are super... Because, let's say, if you're working on how can I explain that? Let's say, I have this asset, right? And because when you lay out a UV, like right now, I have this gumball machine, right? This is a really simple asset, so we don't have a ton of tiles, but let's. At work, you might have something with like 160 tiles, right? And 180, I don't know, 200 tiles. And having UVs, it's so much easier for you to select things and making like masks and painting stuff, projecting and so that's why when I'm layouting my UVs, I always make sure that I have everything separated by materials. Because it makes it like super easy to select and isolate quickly. Because let's say if you're thinking about, oh, you can use PTEX. Don't do that, because PTEX pretty much means you have like, you don't have like UVs like that. It makes like, I only use PTEX once, so I cannot say like, oh, never use it. So maybe some people would use it for something. But with my experience, if you have PTEX, it means that you cannot select anything here, right? You would have to select in this view.
Okay.
It would be a pain in the ass to separate materials properly. Let's say, so I have this gumball machine. And let me show you here. So you basically have three types of materials here, right?
Yep.
It's a little bit, this model is a little bit different, but still. We have this green, this red plastic, and we have this aluminum, which we can consider is pretty much the same material as this one.
We can't see the gumball machine right now. I can't see the gumball machine.
You cannot?
No.
Okay, let me share the window instead of, wait. Can you see it?
Yep, yeah. Perfect.
Cool. Yeah, so let's say we have these three materials right now. We have, I'm going to consider the metal as like one material, right?
Okay.
And then we have the glass and the red plastic.
Yep.
Right? And so let's say I just got this acid and I want to isolate my materials, right?
Yeah.
So what I'm going to do here, I have my Vs separated. Here I have my red plastic.
Okay.
On this tile. And I separated my metal in other few tiles as well here. Well, let me put it like this. It'll be easier.
Gotcha.
Wait a sec. Cool.
So that's the first thing you do once, you know, after completing your model is assign the materials to the different UVs?
Yeah, okay. So let's start from the beginning then. Okay. You finish your model, right? Your model is finished. Your model is done. And or if you are work, gave you the model and they gave you the UVs, mm-hmm. or depending on where you work, you can make your own UVs, which would be better because if you're a texture, kind of know what you need.
Yeah.
Right? So here, and then you import your object in Mari, and that's how it looks. That's our UV view, mm-hmm. and this is our ortho view. So the first thing I do, before doing that, I like to bake my maps. I like to bake my ambient occlusion, my curvature maps, before even starting the texturing process.
Okay.
And I already have them here.
Can you explain
this channel?
What baking means? When you bake them, basically, does that apply it straight to the UVs or not?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
So I have a tutorial explaining how to bake ambient occlusion maps. If you go to my website, you can find the
I'll share it.
The ambient cool, yeah, the ambient occlusion texturing. Well, I forgot the name of it. The ambient occlusion map. Yeah, there's an article there about ambient occlusion. And there's a few different techniques you can use to bake it. And what it does basically, it bakes into your V's, right?
Yeah. Okay, gotcha.
And that's how it looks. That's how it looks in your V's. Yeah.
So what do you
so
use
even
the curvature maps and ambient occlusion for? What is it to add, you know, things like dust, or is it for the shadows? What is it for?
Yeah, so the ambient occlusion, I mostly use it for dust, dirt. If I want to, let's say, if you look at this map. Let me show you quickly here. I'm going to invert this ambient occlusion map because it's easier to understand.
Okay.
What is happening here. Just a second. Let me just... Cool. So if you look here, you can see that the white information is what it's the information that's going to be revealed, right? So we're going to have, like, if you want to have, like, dust inside that occluded area, mm-hmm. right? For example, I don't have a proper
reference
that shows that, but let's say, okay, so we have this guy here, yep. and let's say inside that thing, right? This thing is pretty dusty around here, but let's say inside that thing, you might have some dust collected, right? Like, because dirt from, like, the gumballs or what is that? It's like dog food? Oh my God. I've never seen that. That's weird. So this dog food machine, when these things, they come out of it, it's going to leave, like, some residue collected there, right?
Okay. Yeah.
And it might collect some dust. And the same thing here. Can you see, like, here, how it breaks up the reflection?
Yeah.
There's some, like, collected dust here, which is exactly what we get, like, here, right?
Yeah.
But when you look at this, you're like, okay, but how's that going to be useful? It looks, like, so... But the thing is, this map is only going to help you to isolate this area so you can add more. So it looks, like, really good, right?
Yeah.
So I'm going to show you, like, basic.
Does that map work almost like a mask in Photoshop, in the sense that the black area is hidden and the white area is revealed? So if you were to put one entire texture and apply the ambient occlusion as a mask, you would only have the white areas revealed. Is that how it would work?
Yes, I'm going to show you how I use that now. So I'm going to create a new channel. I'm going to create a new channel called RG Mask Dust. No, actually, I'm going to call it Dust now. Dust Mask. Right? And naming convention is super important. So just make sure you put names everywhere. I'm going to keep it 2K. Gumball. Cool. I'm going to open my channel, and I have this base. I want it to be black so we can see it better. So I'm going to put, like, a color here. Black, that's beautiful. Let's delete this base. Goodbye, base. Cool. And now I'm going to create a new color, a new basic color. I want it to be white. But now I'm going to right click, layer mask, hide all. Okay. Right?
Okay.
And here, I always like to work on in the flat mode, because you can see the textures properly without having any shadow or highlight information. Mm-hmm. But in situations like that, if you have everything black, it's kind of hard to see. So that's why I like to use this color node, so I can change it like this, so just so I can see what I'm looking at right now,
okay.
and then I can change it again later, right?
Yeah.
And in this, within this node, I have my mask. I have it masked, right? So we're not seeing whites here. Mm-hmm. If I cancel this, now I can see it.
Okay, gotcha.
And shift click. So it disabled the mask, right?
Yeah.
But now I'm going to create a mask stack. This is one of the greatest things in Mario. Like, you can create a mask stack, which is pretty much like it's this thing here. It creates another
mask
window where you can add. Mask. Yeah, you can merge masks, blend them as much as you can, and that's super super power. I use that all the time. And this can get a little bit confusing, so make sure that you have everything named properly. So I'm going to put names here. I'm going to call it black background, and this is going to be my dust mask.
Okay.
And I also have to put, like, underscore whatever it is. Right now I'm using a color node, so I like to put call.
Okay.
And for example, using a tileable, I like to write tile. Let me show you tile. I just pressed tab. If you press tab here, I just learned this trick a few months ago, and I'm so happy that I found it. You just press tab, and you can access whatever you want here. Anything you want in Mari.
Okay.
Right? So you can just type here if you want, like, brightness, whatever. So I just tiled, and I'm going to type here, let's say, dust_tile, and I can grab, let me try rust, because I have a rust texture there. I have this texture here, and it's a tileable texture, so it means it's seamless, right? Mm-hmm. There's no seams here. I'm just going to drag this into this tile node, so I have this awesome tile. Rust texture. And you can tile it a few times. Right? Yeah. And you can blend it, stuff.
Okay.
Cool. But okay, back to it. I'm going to delete this now. Go back to my dust mask. So here I have my mask. And I still have my resource channel tab open here, right?
Yeah.
And I'm going to grab my AO mask. And if you click here, you can see it, like just the layer you clicked.
Yeah.
Instead of this is you're seeing the channel view the current channel, the current layer below, just the layer and the paint. And paint or mask, so okay. It's just like whatever this is. So I'm gonna grab this. I'm gonna press Ctrl Shift, drag it here. So this is like a shared layer now.
Okay.
So whatever I do here is gonna affect this layer. So be really careful with that. And the sharing layers can be really really useful in production because it can save you a lot of time, but if you modify it without, you know, if you forget that it's a shared layer, it can be a pain. So it can affect everything else. So just be careful with that. Cool. I'm going to close this now because I don't need it anymore. And I'm going to see my channel. And I'm going to make it black again.
Okay.
And look at that. Look at that. So we have the perfect representation of the AO mask, right?
Okay.
Because we have a black background and a white collar. And that shared AO is revealing the whites, right?
Gotcha.
So it's pretty much the same map. And if I invert this now, it's going to show me the inverse, right? Oh, of course, it's going to show you the inverse. Cool. And now it's like you can do whatever. So what I like to do usually, I like to bring my curvature or AO. It depends on what you're doing. In this case, I have my AO. I inverted it and are like breaking this up. So I wanted to make it look more interesting. And I'm going to start by adding like a few levels, change the levels a little bit, make it more sharp and localized.
Okay.
And on top of it, I'm going to use a tile. I have a few tileables here that I brought in beforehand. This is one of the tiles I like the most. It's just like some smudges, you know, like some fingerprints and smears, you know, and this is really, really cool. There's a really good website if you want to find like stencils like that. It's called Polygon.
I didn't know about that one.
You can find like, let me show you. It's like super handy. Let me just change my screen here for a bit. Can you see anything right now?
Yeah, yeah.
Can you see it, the website?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so this website is really, really cool, and they have this surface imperfections. So they give you like the black and white information already, and they have all this amazing like stencils.
Is this, so are these just image maps, or are they, you know, dedicated to a specific software?
No, this is like just texture maps.
Okay.
They give you like a full res image, and this is great, man. This is really, really good, because I mean, you can get some of this stuff like from photos. That's what I do actually, depending on what I want. I just like take colored photos and I just make my own stencils. But it's really hard to find fingerprints online, to find like proper
maps.
Yeah, fingerprint as much as online that have like the good range, right? Like if you look at that, it's perfect, right?
Yeah.
And yeah, so I have a few variations that you can use. And even like if you want scratches and things like that.
That's pretty awesome, man.
Yeah, it's a really good website. And
are they expensive to get, or?
I think you can even like get a 30-day trial first.
Oh,
so
wow.
You can download and see if it's worth it.
Okay.
But I think it is affordable. I mean, and if you work with that, in my case, right, it's always a good choice. The same thing with textures.com.
Yeah.
I know that you guys might know this, right? This is like the most famous website. Yeah, this is the website that everyone uses for textures, and it's amazing. But have those stencils, you know, like that's the only downside. They don't have stencils. And this one, you have like a free credits,
every
right?
Day,
so
yeah.
You can download every day. You have 15 free credits. So yeah, it's a good. It's definitely an awesome website. And the thing with texturing is I realized that I don't use a lot of textures, you know, like I do have my own texture library that I use. This one. Can you see it? Can
yeah.
you see my...
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So I have this tile library here that I've been collecting for like almost 3 years now. I have all these textures, but to be really honest, I only use like a few. Unless I'm doing something really specific,
mm-hmm.
I go and try and find something. But here, man, let me show you like the textures that I used. This one is my favorite texture of all time, and this is free. I found this online. I'm gonna see if I find the link and I send it to you.
Okay, perfect.
But
I'll
dude, look at this variation. Look at this. You know, you can get so many like because I what I like about this texture is like the surface, right? This can give you a really nice bump information and gloss.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to show you in Mari how I use this texture. But even the color, you know, like you can dye change the hue and get like so much color information here, which is insane.
What would you use this for? Would it be for like a diffuse map, or what sort of map would you make out of this?
That's another thing that is important to mention here. If you were a texture painter, you have to think outside the box, right? You cannot be only thinking, okay, this is metal, so I'm only going to use this for metals, right?
Mm-hmm.
You should always be thinking about patterns. You know, like, for example, when I was working on the cassowary, which is like the bird painted, I've used like this texture like to put like some pores on it, like tiny pores. And this is like fruit, you know, and but it, like if you make this desaturated and crank the values, you can grab a great like pore map, right? And so, and the same thing with the marble, dude. Marble is one of the greatest textures. Like you can get so many like different things with marble,
mm-hmm.
you know. If you make this a black and white mask. Let me show you. I have this
Estep is asking, how long did the Gumball project take you from like concept to final product?
The Gumball was a weird project because I started the idea when I one day I was looking for a project, and I wanted to do something simple. I was back in school, second semester. I wanted to do like a project that was simple but interesting, that had like a strong emotional connection. In school, I was like thinking about it, like, oh my God, how I'm gonna do this, I don't know. And then I woke up one day, and then I have this book by James Gurney called Color and Light, which is by far my favorite art book ever. Is oh my God, I love James Gurney. And he had this painting of a gumball machine, and I'm like, oh my God, that's it. You know, like that's my project right here. And then the next day I drew like a few sketches. I actually have it here. Let me show you. Dun, dun, dun. Yeah, so this is like my process. I remember this is the can you see it? Yeah, so this is the painting, the Gurney painting, right? And back then I decided to make the scene, right? The gumball scene. So I started like to block the scenes and, you know, block the shapes and everything and match the light. I drew like a few sketches to understand the shapes of it. Yeah, so like this is just like the blocking stage, right? Just main shapes without any detail at all, like matching the silhouettes. This is like the drawing, and I'm just trying to match like curves. Yeah, I went crazy with it. But just like you said before, Momo, I was learning a lot from the process itself rather than the final result, right? Because after this happened, I was like into this gumball machine project. I stopped to start my demo reel. So in my demo reel, I had the gas mask, the camera, and the cassowary. So I had to stop the gumball machine, and I said, one day we'll be back to it, right? So it took me like, I would say, a week. No, not even that. I think like almost a week to model the gumball. And it took, I mean, I think if you look at the model, it's quite simple. But back then, I was like the bad at modeling. I was still like learning a lot about modeling, and I had to get a lot of help from a friend of mine to get like this bevel working properly. And I was really crazy about like matching all the details exactly, you know, like because okay, I can model like something close to that. That's what I did pretty quickly, but getting the proper, you know, bevels and curves, like this curve was hard for me to match, right? As you can see here, this was like the first iterations. It was quite soft and w wrong. It took me like almost a week to model, and I stopped working on it. And when I finished when I finished school and a job, I decided to revisit the gumball after I finished the cassowary. So because I was at home, I'm like, okay, it's time to go back to it. So it took me like, I don't know, a week to texture and
So,
looked up.
a week to
But I
model, a
was going,
week to texture.
to texture and looked up, right? And I wasn't working every day, like the whole day. I was working when I was coming back from work, and it was supposed to be just a test when I published the gumball. Because I wanted to make the whole scene, right? But I just wanted to do like a and look dev. That's the one that I posted. But I was surprised by the reaction, by the online reception of it. You know, like so many people were like really excited about it, and they really liked the idea and the concept. You know, because it's such a simple concept and broad, but so many people have like a good memory of like the gumball machine. They remember their childhood, right? And And when it comes to like scene, I said, you know what, let's move on. You know, like I don't want to, I just don't want to finish, like do the scene anymore. I learned so much from the process already that I just want to do something else. Right. And that's what I've been doing a lot. You know, like I haven't like published anything new yet because I've been doing a lot of like quick tests and projects on my, you know, like, my personal time.
Okay.
I have a really, really big project right now that I'm working on with a friend of mine, but I cannot talk about it right now because we want it to be a big surprise, but it's a Warcraft project and we're making like super realistic. It's going to be like, we want to, get close to the movie style, you know, like the kind of realistic stylized stuff. And we have a friend that's working on the groom. So my friend, he sculpted, he gave me the model and he's an amazing modeler, sculptor. He's great. And
you're dealing with the entire model. Texturing side of things.
Yes, I'm texturing. I already finished UVs for it. So I'm texturing it, shading and lighting it, leading it. So, and a friend of mine from Scanline, she's working on the groom. And she's amazing. She's also learning a lot about grooming as well.
I'm not familiar with the term.
Grooming is hair, fur. So she had a few experiences back in. She used to work at MPC and she worked on Jungle Book for a bit.
Okay.
And so she's really, really nice and. We went to do this together as like a collab project, you know, and I think this is going to be really, really cool when it comes out. And again, learning a lot from the process rather than the final result, right?
Yeah.
Of course, we're going to finish it, but I feel like I'm learning so much from the process that I'm taking my time to learn and, you know, keep going with it.
One question I have, you know, like I remember seeing... I believe it was your spacecraft project, the WASP, right?
Yes.
You had a, like you were collaborating with a few friends. I can't remember if it was that project, but you were collaborating and you guys had a schedule for it.
Yes, yes. Actually, it wasn't a collaboration.
No, you were all doing it together and each had their deadlines, right? Something like that.
Yes, because it was our final project at Think Tank.
Okay.
We only had a month to deliver it, right? And me and my friend Christian Peck, who's also a texture painter, is a great friend of mine. Hey, Christian. Hey. And my other friend, Matthias, we were at school like all day long, right? So we wanted to like make it proper and make it like really organized and everything. And since everyone had like its own specialty, because Matthias was really good at modeling and Christian knew everything about like the softwares itself, how to use Mari. And I was the guy who had like more like a visual knowledge because I knew more about lighting and like how to look at things proper. So we shared experience among ourselves, you know, so it was amazing. Matthias would sit with us and teach us like how to model something properly. And Christian would sit and teach us how to use it. And back then it was really, I mean, if you look at WASP nowadays, it's really bad when it comes to texturing, you know, like the maps, like spec, roughness. It's really like primitive if I look at it right now, right? But even then, it was an amazing experience for us. And having the schedule helped us a lot, you know, just like by helping each other all the time.
Gotcha. We have probably about 15 more minutes to go. Guys, if you have any questions, feel free to send them over.
I think I didn't finish that the dust thing, right?
Let
me keep going. So what I was doing here, I was just like dialing my AO map, right? And on top of it, I'm going to add a tileable. This what we were talking about, right?
Okay.
I'm going to tile a few like a few.
You're going to resize it?
I'm going to repeat it a few times, right? Okay. So I'm looking for like the size of like a, let's say I wanted to mimic like the human thumb, right?
Yeah.
Something like that someone was touching it or like was handling this machine. Mm-hmm. So I don't want it to be too small or too big. So I'm just going to, yeah, maybe this is good enough.
Okay.
Yeah. So just something that makes sense, right?
Mm-hmm.
And again, the idea is I was like, you want to tell a story with this thing, right? You don't want it to be, oh, that's it, right? Like, I think that's right. No, just think about, like, what is the story of this machine? Like, maybe some kid was, like, putting his hands all over it when he was looking for the gumball he wanted. Or yeah. Maybe the guy who owns this machine was putting this machine somewhere, right? So don't just put textures and say, oh, okay, it looks correct, you know, but just add a little story to it. And now that I have my smudges here, I'm going to change my blending mode and boom.
Okay.
You know, like it's like a really quick solution, but it works right away.
So right. It almost works like Photoshop layers, like the
exactly
the layers you have in your panel, like the shared AO, inverted levels, and so on. Does it so it calculates everything from like top down? Anything that's on top takes precedence to whatever's underneath it, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
And if you put like into a group, it works like Photoshop as well. So if I put this into a group here. It doesn't calculate this multiply from here.
Okay.
Right?
It calculates it from
unless,
the group.
Unless I use this thing, which is new on Mari 3.0, which is the pass-through mode, right?
Gotcha.
But if not, you have to use the multiply here in the group instead.
Gotcha.
But this is not enough because this look like too procedural. And that's one of the things that you should avoid. It should avoid that procedural look to it. So you can add more things. You can break it up even more, right? So you can add like let's say you can even add like a procedural cloud to break that look even more.
Okay.
You know, and you can change it here. Change the blending mode to overlay and like lower it a little bit and see those seams.
Yeah.
It's always a good idea to paint them if they're visible.
Yeah.
And usually what I do, I just create a layer on top called seam fix. Add this bevel that I used and I just select this and just paint over on top and bake it.
So you paint on top and then bake it again?
Yeah, I just project the smudges, the same texture.
Wow.
And bake it. So when you look at it, right, you're just
that's
fixing
awesome.
The seam.
Yeah.
Yeah, like the same thing here. Just paint those seams, woohoo, goodbye seam, right? And then you just bake it. So, yeah, and now I want to show you guys the curvature, how to use a curvature map pretty quickly. And that's why I have this turbine model here. First of all, I just want to say thank you, Garrett. Garrett is a good friend of mine from Think Tank. He is a really good modeler, and he gave me this model just so I could show you guys the curvature technique. So his name is Garrett Matsuno, and you can find his on ArtStation. He on ArtStation, and Yeah, thank you, Garrett. So I wanted to use this model to show you the curvature mask because we have like so much information here, right? Like so many corners and different surfaces that it's better to show the curvature
Why
and
would you
how you can use
use
it properly.
a curvature map instead of an AO map for this? What's the difference
Because if you
between
look at the
both?
AO map, because the AO map, first of all, it's based on the occluded areas, right? Anything that is touching, like where the objects meet,
Okay.
occlusion happening. But the curvature, you can get. Let me show you. This is messy. I'm sorry, guys. Yeah, don't do this. Don't keep it everything without a name. Yeah, so this is a curvature map,
Okay.
right? And I'm currently writing a new tutorial, like explaining how can you bake different curvature maps using ZBrush. I love to use ZBrush for curvature maps. You can use it by masking by smoothness. And I'm gonna show you guys later. I'm gonna write a tutorial and let you guys know how to bake it properly. But it pretty much like masks the edges, right? The
Okay.
curvature mask is also known as edge mask, right?
Gotcha.
And you can also get it Substance Painter, which gives you a pretty good mask as well. I've been using that, and it's quite awesome. But here you can bake the curvature in Mari as well, because in Mari 3 you have the Modo render. Have you heard about that, Momo?
Yeah.
It's a Modo render integrated in Mari, so you can bake the curvature as well. So it's pretty good, even though it's a little bit slower
Okay.
than ZBrush.
Yeah.
It's quite powerful. So if you don't have ZBrush or anything else, cool. So if you look at this is the curvature mask, and here. Wait, and this is. Oh, do I have my. I don't even have my AO map here. Do I? Yeah, so the curvature doesn't care about the occluded areas. You know, it just grabs the information from the edges
Okay.
and it gives you that nice soft edge fall off, right? Which can be really good for like if you want to add some and some like oil like marks on the edges, you know, like some burn masks. So how you should think about like when you're thinking about like because this masks the curvature and the AO, they're often called masks, right? The masks that are gonna help you to achieve details. And here with this RGB mask that I created, you can see that this mask can give you like a nice like darkening detail for free, right? So I always start my texturing process with this mask just to give like a broad detail, like a broad not detail a broad I always start like with something like with large details, right? Like I always start procedurally by throwing like basic textures and using the masks that I have to get the proper look that I'm looking for. And then I come in and I start painting whatever I need, right?
Okay.
And I want to actually, I'm going to show you guys why this thing look white, red, blue, and green. Some people might be thinking like, how the hell I'm going to use this shit? That's what I That's how I react when I heard about this thing called RGB masks in texturing. When I learned how to texture in Mari, I was always like, oh, masks should be black and white, right? And that's how I used to export things from Mari. So the basic idea here is we use that a lot in production. When you have, let's say you want to export masks to use in V-Ray, right? Or any other renderer. And it wants you blend the, you have a blend material in V-Ray, right?
Yeah.
And you have your let's say your like an you have like metal.
Gotcha.
And you want to use another metal and reveal that with the scratches, correct?
Okay.
So you're going to use a reveal that metal underneath the metal that you have as a base, correct? And you want a black and white information through in V-Ray. So what you but so why does this thing look green? So how are you going to use that? And the answer is the reason why we use RGB masks is because you can add three types of masks into the same channel.
Gotcha.
Without losing any. So you have less. You have like more information in one channel rather than create different channels for each damage. And how are you going to isolate that in V-Ray? And it's super simple. You just have to isolate each color. You can, because we have RGB, right? So we have red, green, and blue.
So do you assign...
And in V-Ray...
In V-Ray, do you assign each color to a different map or a different texture? And that's how you would get the different effects on, let's say, for this, like, worn effect?
Yeah, you just have to... In V-Ray, you have a color corrector node in Max, or in Maya, you can have a color corrector node as well, that you can choose each channel separately, right? And it's important here in Mari that you have the full range of the color. Instead of having the red like this, it must be pure red, right? So when you isolate the color, you don't lose any detail. And in Mari, you also have like this layer called copy channel, which can isolate the colors RGB, right?
Yeah.
So I'm here and show it to you guys. So you can do the same thing in V-Ray or in the other renderer if you want. So if you just click here, copy channel, you have your red. Your reds being like and if you change it to, oh wait, I have my branches. If you change it to blue, you have the other D, which is the just smudges that I put all around as if it's like, oh, just some smudges, right? So I don't have my red information here. I only have my blues.
Okay.
And with the green ones, I have my scratches.
That's awesome.
You know,
man.
So that's why when you're exporting this, you can just put here, let's say, edge mask, edge wear. This one, I'm going to call it dust. And this one, I'm going to call it scratches. Right?
Yeah.
And then you can just isolate them in your renderer with the detail you want, right?
That's awesome.
And this one, I have this. What does he have this thing here?
You have a quick question by Edgar asking if he's planning to go into lighting as a technical director. What could he be beneficial to learn more about texturing and Mari? How important are Mari and texturing knowledge when it comes to lighting?
I mean, it's hard for me to answer this question because at least at Scanline where I work, the lighters they're considered generalists, okay. Right? Like people that can do mostly like everything from modeling, like simple modeling to lighting, right? Like, but I don't think it's like something essential, like something that you have to be like really good in Mari. I don't think you have to learn it like a lot, you know. Like I think Mari it's a software that is super easy to understand. If you know Photoshop, So if, especially if you want to be a technical director, I don't think it, it's like something super important. Hey, learn it just like the basic, just for yourself. Maybe if they ask you like, oh, can you paint like a mask to isolate something in the scene, you know? Because these things happen, you know, like you never know. Depending on where you're working, they might ask you to do other things. I mean, they ask me stuff like that I never did before. I learned on the spot, you know. That's the beauty of being able to learn things as fast as you to turn, you know, like to learn things quickly. And people understand that. If you're honest with them, saying like, hey, I don't know this, but I can learn. That's what it matters. Now, just like show them the willingness to learn things.
Gotcha.
You know?
Yep. We're going to wrap it soon, Paul. But yeah, if you could finish the demo, that'd be awesome. And then, guys, if you have any last questions, feel free to ask them now. Otherwise, as soon as Paul is done, we'll wrap up the demo and meet you guys for the next one next week.
Cool. Yeah. I'm just going to show, the last thing I'm going to show is how to use that awesome texture that I showed you before.
Yep.
And how I usually like to use it. And I'm really sorry, guys. I had like so many things to share with you, but we didn't have enough time. And it's like we got like excited about so many things, and I went sideways talking about
it. That's how the stream is. Like the conversations are like on alive on their own. But dude, like, you know, I'd be super happy, and I think the guys would be super happy to have you again, because this is definitely interesting, and we could do a part two for sure.
Yeah, and thank you thank you again, Momo, for inviting me, that's why it's important for you guys. Like, if you, like, for example, I got like the opportunity to work in the industry and sharing stuff, and then I met Momo. He came to me asking questions, and I wanted to help him because he was super nice and super responsive. You know, we talked about that, Momo, and life, like, it goes around, right? Like, now you're part of the Learn Squared community, and you to be part of it. So that's why it's so important to help people, because you never know, right? Like, maybe that person, like, maybe in the future you're going to be hiring me as a texture painter, right? So that's why it's important to always be nice, you know, like never let like the ego consume you, right? Yeah. Let's say, oh, just because you're working and you're doing something that you think is more important, it doesn't mean anything, you know, like, so if you have the opportunity. And of course, we know sometimes people don't have time to answer everyone properly, but just don't be a dick, right? Yeah. That's the major rule in the industry. I think it's just like, don't be a dick.
You have a couple questions that came in. They're pretty short. One of them is, what do you prefer, Mari or Substance Painter?
That's interesting question, because I've been getting that quite a lot recently. The thing is, I just started learning Substance, so I cannot tell you like 100% like, oh, I prefer Substance or Mari, but I've been using Mari for almost 2-3 years now, and I love it, dude. I really like the software for the flexibility and the amount of things you can do with it. And I have a good relationship with the Foundry people, so they've been, you know, helping me quite a lot, and I no complaints. But I'm also giving a shot to Substance, because I mean, it's like they have some cool features, right? So I don't think you should be stuck with a software, you know, like, yeah. I think you should test everything and give it a shot. If it gives you like, it's just a tool, right? Like, makes your work easily, you know, so just try it and see if it's good or not.
Yeah, because at the end of the day, it's getting good results. Yeah, go ahead.
I've been having like good results with Substance. I'm actually using it for my next project, mm-hmm. the Warcraft thing that I mentioned before. But I'm still using Mari for the major part, because I think it's easier for me to learn to do things. But I'm definitely giving it a shot. You know, I'm definitely learning things with it.
How is the learning curve? How has it been easier to learn Substance? Did you pick it up faster than you did Mari, or how's the interface and all that?
It was quite fast, actually. Okay. I think it was quite easy for me to understand the idea of it. Mm-hmm. The only thing is the normal map thing, because I don't use normal maps that often. So just like getting my head around a little bit. But overall, it's like super easy and intuitive. It's funny because one of the softwares that I had trouble with like learning was ZBrush.
Yeah,
because interface, man, that thing killed me. I was like, what the fuck is wrong with these people, right? They want it to be like artistic, when it wants to be intuitive, right? Yeah. For an artist, to me it's the contrary. It's like, what the fuck is going on here? I still have trouble in ZBrush sometimes, but I actually like it quite a lot nowadays.
Well, Alex Fugini has a ZBrush course on LearnSquared, and apparently it's been answering a lot of, like, I know Ash tried it for the last 6 or 7 years and couldn't pick it up, but now he's having a really good time with it. And I'm actually going to be uploading some of the mentorship homeworks, and dude, it's badass. Like, these guys have, like, you know, done some really cool stuff. So I'll probably have them tomorrow or the day after, so you guys can have a look at some of that ZBrush goodness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I actually want to do like some, I actually want to practice more sculpting, because I did quite a few back in school and I wasn't that bad. I studied anatomy for a while on CGMA. Yeah. I had the course with Michael Hampton, and that guy is a beast, man. And I learned a lot. Anatomy, but I just stopped because I wanted to focus on the texturing part.
Yeah,
but I do love like sculpting and organics. So, Momo, let me just show you what I'm doing right now.
Yeah,
I'm just creating a quick bump and metal maps here. I just used the texture that I showed you before, right?
Yeah, that metal one.
And the metal one, yeah. This one here. And what I'm trying to do here, I'm just trying to get like a few values with the bump and gloss map. They have the same repetition, so I want them to correlate. I want them to be to match, and you're gonna understand why. Because here I'm gonna show you the shaders. I'm just gonna add like a quick Beckman shader, and I'm gonna add here a quick channel, like a gray quick channel. And I'm going to put my gloss into the specular roughness and my bump into this bump slot. And just so you guys can visualize how this looks like.
Okay.
Wait. I think let me check the increase this and make it rough. Yeah, let me change it a little bit. Where is it? Bump, 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 bump. Wait, bump. Yeah, so this is just like a quick, like just by using that texture, you get like a nice, quick surface variation, you know? And one thing I like to do as well is just like adding a breakup, a big noise to it.
Okay.
So if I just add this and I change it to multiply, see?
Okay.
So just by adding this, you already add more realism
aspect
to it.
Of it.
Yeah, and the break is one of the most important things in texturing. is nothing in real life is like super like how can I say that? It's not like
super constant and perfect and
constant, yeah, perfect, yeah. So just always think about breakups, especially on the diffuse, because nothing is gonna be flat. Like let's say you have something quite new, but it still have like that, you know, that tiny color variation that's gonna bring the realism to it. And if you look at, like, let's look at that gumball machine again. You know, like even things like that, see that this is, of course, this is being used, but even on the blues here, you have like some like slightly color variance on it.
Yeah.
And that adds a lot to it. Right. And here, even though like you don't see any bump information, you do have like some surface like imperfections.
Yeah.
Right. Which is, if you put it there, you know, like if this, you cannot definitely see that surface variation, right? And if you match that variation with a gloss and add some breakup to it, it's going to look super awesome. And here, of course, in the glass, see that amazing gloss breakup, right? It's smudges, exactly. And you can definitely get that with this texture. With this texture that we were talking about before, right?
Yeah.
Look at that.
Yeah. So.
Like, and you can add. Yeah.
No, go ahead. Finish.
No, it's just like you can add this, and of course, add like even more complexity to it by adding like, let's say, pencils on top of it, just blending them, right?
Yeah.
So nothing. Don't think about like, okay, I have the perfect texture for this. No, just. About think it further, right? Like think, how can I achieve something even more interesting, right? By blending different stencils, adding different textures to it. So yeah, so always think about that.
So for someone who's not using Mari, like this is something I would do in Photoshop, because I'm not using Mari. So I would, you know, let's say I have my smudge map, you know, let's say I have some concrete map and a few scratches. I could go in Photoshop, blend those three to get like the exact thing that I'm looking for, or, you know, make 2-3 maps out of them. And then once I make them seamless, bring them into whatever software that I'm using and blend those in there to get that same effect, right?
Exactly. And I'm going to show you what I just said. Let me show you how can you create a quick diffuse.
Okay.
With a slightly break up. It's going to be pretty quick. I'm just going to add this, let's say, a red paint on it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So this looks boring, and right? So just like a solid color. And I'm going to show you one of the texture. This texture, I use it quite a lot for breakup. And some people would never like think about this texture because it's a concrete texture. It's called.
People were asking earlier, yeah, if you'd be interested in. Paul, do you have a Gumroad?
Not yet.
Okay.
I'm definitely thinking about creating a quick texturing course for something like really simple, like simple objects, yeah. You know, like talking about here, but in a broader scale,
showing all
the process that I use in the industry. Yeah. But if you guys are interested, please drop me a message and let me know if you
want you that. You have two
just
requests.
Like right now, I'm super.
You have two requests. Yeah, people are asking. People are asking. You know, are you going to be teaching this stuff anytime soon? Because they're definitely interested. A few people asked if you are doing mentorships where you take on a couple students, people were also asking if it's possible if there's a few texture maps that you could make available for them. I don't know if you bought those or what the license on them, but That's a question that came up.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to think about that because some of them I got it when I was back in school, and they have like a CG textures textures.com account. So I got it when I was back in school, right? So I cannot give it because they are copyright,
Yeah.
you know, all these things. But you can definitely get it. Most of these textures you can find on CG textures, and just make it a stack just by going to Photoshop and changing values, you know. And it's quite quick, you know. Just like grab the texture, like this one here. This used to be like colored, right? It used to have
Yeah.
like a basic color to it. So you just saturate that, and you already get like this breakup to it. And that's what you should look for when looking for breakups. I have a few other textures here. Let me see. Yeah. So yeah, this texture became this one, right? See? I just desaturated that and changed the values a little bit so I can use that as a breakup. And let me show you quickly how I use that as a breakup. I just use the breakup texture on top of my color, right? I'm gonna change the repetition so it doesn't look weird. And the only thing I do is just I change it to overlay or whatever, and I lower the opacity.
Okay.
Look at that. So just by changing the blending mode and lowering the opacity, I already get like this amazing breakup to it, right? And things like that make a huge difference, right? And the same thing I can do, like let's say add a basic color to it, just with a color with a slight different variation. Or actually even better, let me add an HSV layer, which changed the hue and saturation, right? And I'm gonna lower the saturation, and I'm gonna add a mask stack. And now I'm gonna bring that awesome curvature mask that I showed you before. And look at that. And now if I change my HSV here, I already get like that color desaturation there.
For the
And I
edge
can change
layer.
it more. Edge layer. Yeah, because if you look at things in real life, the edges are quite like desaturated in some material, right? It doesn't have to be that crazy, you know, like right now, but just like a little bit, it already adds like some life to it. And again, you can levels here and make it broader or sharper and add a breakup to it, right? So look at that. Gives you like a good starting point. And yeah, so just add like a pattern on top. And just add this and then overlay. Yeah, so you break up that mask, you know, a little bit more.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah, so it's all like making things less flat and boring, right? Just adding more detail, and even like that. So you already get like some darkening around the edges, and it's way more interesting than just that flat color.
And then on top of that, you could add the AO mask to start adding like the dust and all of that.
Yeah, and there's also like a different mindset. You should when you're working in the industry, it depends on how you're going to be working as a texture artist. Sometimes you're going to do your own look dev, right? So you can do whatever. You can make masks like I showed you. You can make your RGB masks, or all these details here that I showed you in the RGB mask, you can bake it in your diffuse. You don't need to put that into separate masks. You can just bake it in your diffuse if you want. But if you're working with someone else as a look dev artist, good that they have control. right? They could do whatever they want with these masks.
Yeah.
Instead of having something, baked into the diffuse, mm-hmm. it's going to be really hard for them to adjust the dust if you have it on your diffuse and your glossiness, you know? Because if you, like, usually when I'm working with my own projects, I already know the values that I want. So bother, you know, by creating masks like this. But if I'm working with someone else, I want to give them full control, right? Because easier for him to adjust values or whatever he wants to do, right?
Yeah.
So it's always about mindset. Just think about, like, that's why communication is key as well. Just talk to the person that you're working with and say, like, hey, that's it, right?
Man, this is awesome. This is awesome. This definitely calls for a part two, man. I don't know what you guys think in the chat, but I'm totally down for a part two, and you know, we'll have to schedule that. But it's been really awesome, man. Like, we've never done like a 2-hour stream, so and people are still sticking around in the chat. So I think this is a good sign that, you know, we're doing something interesting here. Yeah, guys, if you guys have any last question, otherwise we're going to wrap this up. Don't worry, I'll make sure we bring Paul back for some Mari goodness, and who knows, he might have some little special for you guys on the next one. But yeah, Paul, how can people reach you? Go ahead.
I show you my website and Facebook and stuff. Can I just talk about the project that we have going on?
The live
stories.
Yeah, go ahead.
So me and my friend Leonardo Graydon, he's a great modeler, and he works at Method here in Vancouver. We have a project called CG Lifestyle, and it's pretty much like a live. It's a project that aims to connect artists around the world by interviewing them in live on Facebook, just by asking them questions, so they can tell about their lives, right? And we're gonna have like a really fun discussion in the industry here in Vancouver, and in the future we have plans to go, you know, to LA and visit this as well, and other parts of the world, hopefully. But yeah, if you want to help our project, please access our website, cglifestories.com. We have our Facebook page as well. And what we want to do is pretty much the same thing that the Learn Square does, is just like keep helping you guys, bringing useful knowledge and bringing more information if you want to work in the game and film industry, right? And yeah, so if you guys could help us, it would be awesome.
Yeah, you guys should definitely check it out. Send me a link to, cause you guys have a page, a Facebook page for the project, right?
Yes.
So just send it over. I'll share it with people. But yeah, like when I started learning texturing, that's like, I probably attended 2 or 3 of the CG Live stories already. And basically, it's a Facebook Live stream, so you get to ask your question live and get answers on the spot. And a lot of them, a lot of the conversations are perhaps more about, you know, your journey getting to your goals than at least from what I've seen so far, than a technical stream like what we did today. But that might, I don't know. What are your plans actually, Paul, like in the future? What sort of streams are you guys planning on having?
So our main goal with the CG Live Stories is to interview people that industry for a while, but also people that just entered the industry, right?
Yeah.
Game and film industry. Because I realized that important to hear from those guys that just got in. And because it's going to be like, for someone that just entered the industry, like just let's say someone know what to do, hearing from someone that just got in, it will feel like it's more reachable, right? Because if you just talk to people that entered the 20 years ago, things were like super different back then, right? And even like for me, I entered the industry 2 years ago and it was already quite different. So we want to make that bridge and expose like amazing artists that just entered the industry and they're well known yet, but also talk to like really experienced guys and you know, just get their opinion about the industry and answer questions live. And we want to make it something less technical, like you said. It's gonna be more like a really like buddy talk, like, hey, how's it going? You know? And actually I'm gonna announce here our first like guest on the CG Live Stories. So we haven't announced this yet, but waited until today to, you know, to tell you guys. And our first guest is gonna be Fernando Royley, and he works at ILM. And he recently worked at Doctor Strange, and he's gonna be he's probably gonna win an Oscar today, hopefully, because it was an amazing movie. And he's a great guy. He's like a great friend as well. So we're gonna be interviewing him. We're gonna put things on our Facebook, so you know, keep it just like our page and keep an eye on it. Super awesome to talk to him about it and like get like his view of the industry.
All right, thank you guys. Thank you for showing up and for sticking around. This was a long one, but I hope it's been informative. We're definitely going to have Paul for part two, three, four, five, and six, as Aaron is asking. Definitely. Well, if you guys have anyone you'd like to have on these streams just you guys, I'll just post my email. Just hit me up. Send me the names. I'll try to hunt them down. And if I can get anything going, man, I'll make it happen. But I was excited for this one with Paul, and it was a blast. So we're definitely going to have a part two for this one. So guys, you guys have a good week, and catch you guys next Sunday for the next one. All right, have a good
Yeah,
one.
thank you guys. Thank you so much, guys, and thank you, Momo, again for this opportunity. And if you guys have any questions, please, you can add me on Facebook, on my personal Facebook page. I'd be glad to help. I also have my page, Paul H, facebook.com/PaulHPaulino. Yeah, you can add me if you want and ask any questions you might have. Yeah, it'd be awesome, guys. And thank you again for everything, really.
All right, guys. Catch you next time. Peace.
See ya. Thank you, guys.